are concerned. In any engine, the combustion of fuel with oxygen in combustion chamber provides the energy necessary to drive the automobile. In SI engine, the liquid fuel and air are generally mixed prior to their arrival in the combustion chamber, that is outside the engine cylinder. Whereas in case of diesel engines, the fuel and air, they are mixed separately. They are mixed inside the combustion chamber. In diesel engine, the fuel is injected into the engine cylinder at the end of the compression stroke. And as far as the spark ignition engines are concerned, the process of preparing the air-fuel mixture, it is called carburation. And the device used to do this carburation is called the carburetor. The basic fuel supply system in petrol engine consists of a fuel tank, fuel lines, fuel pump, fuel filters, air cleaner, carburetor, and inlet and exhaust manifold. The system responsible for preparing the correct mixture of air and petrol and directing this mixture to each of the multi-cylinder engines is known as induction system. The intake manifold is a ducting pipe where the fuel and air mixture is supplied through this inlet manifold through the open inlet valve to the combustion chamber of the cylinder. Okay. You can see this is how the induction system, as far as the spark ignition is concerned. The carburetor is there. Air is taken from the atmosphere and fuel is taken from the fuel is supplied to the carburetor from the fuel tank. And in the carburetor, the mixing will happen. And the air proportionate air fuel mixture, then it is supplied to the, you can see the intake manifold. And at the exit of the carburetor, you can see a throttle valve which controls the amount of air and petrol mixture to be supplied to the engine cylinder. Okay. And you can see the inlet valve and you can see the inlet manifold, intake manifold or inlet manifold at the exhaust valve and exhaust manifold. And this is the piston and cylinder arrangement. This is how the induction system. One more figure I can show you as far as the induction system. Here you can get the clear picture. Okay. Air, it is supplied to the carburetor by passing through the air filter. Okay. Fuel is supplied to the carburetor from the fuel tank. Fuel filter, it passes through the filter, fuel filter, and the fuel pump in there. The fuel pump, it pumps the petrol from the fuel tank to the carburetor after passing through the fuel filter. And the carburetor will mix the air and fuel in the carburetor. And this mixture is supplied to the engine combustion chamber of the engine cylinder. This is how the induction system in spark ignition is works out. As far as the fuels are concerned, generally, the majority of the automobiles using the fossil fuels as the fuel for the combustion chamber. The fossil fuels, in fact, the petroleum products like petrol, diesel, and gas. And in some cases, the coal is also used. This is also referred as fossil fuel. And the nuclear fuel, there are some nuclear radioactive isotopes are there. These are not used as a fuel for automobile in commercial, but this application is restricted to the R&D. If the lab experiments work out to be successful, then a day may come, even the radioactive isotopes can be used as a fuel for automobiles. Okay. At present, majority, 95% of the automobiles are using this fossil fuel as the fuel. Now, because of using more and more fossil fuels, more usage of fossil fuels deplete these fossil fuels. Okay, now from today, after 30 years from today, the fuels, whatever the sources we have, the fossil fuel sources, whatever we have, which are used as fuel for automobiles, may deplete and we may require to go for the alternative fuel. What are the alternative fuel? Why the alternative fuel is necessary? Because presently, as I said, 95% of the automobile which are in operation globally, they are using the fossil fuel as the fuel for automobiles. Okay, because of more dependency on fossil fuels, what happens is, so these fossil fuels are depleting at a faster rate and they may not last more than 30 to 40 years from today. So we may have to look for an alternative fuel to the existing fossil fuels for fuel to the automobiles. Then what are the alternative fuels for the fuel and automobile? The biofuels, it is one of the renewable type of fuel. Still, it is not commercially come into market, but it is at the research level. And this can be used as a fuel for automobiles. Presently, the biofuels are used as a fuel for generating electricity. But biofuel as a fuel, it is not used commercially for automobiles. And as far as the biomass is concerned, this is one of the another alternative fuel. And this is the production industry whereby living and recently dead biological material, which can be used as fuel or for production of the fuel. And algae oil is also you can be used as a alternative fuel for the automobiles. But still, this is also not practically come into existence to the commercial, but some vehicles in Europe, they're using this algae fuel as a fuel for automobiles. And now the another very important alternative fuel for this automobiles, this is biodiesel. And to some extent, some of the vehicles are in operation by using this biodiesel as a fuel. What is biodiesel? Biodiesel, generally it is made up of animal fats or vegetable oils. What are the vegetable oils? Okay, the plants such as jatropha plant, soybean plant, sunflower oil, corn oil, peanut oil, palm oil, coconut oil, and sesame oil. These are the oil can be used as biodiesel fuels. One, the fats from these oils are filtered, and the filtered oil can be used as a fuel for automobile. But this also, it has not come into commercially, but some vehicles are using this biodiesel as a fuel for automobiles. And alcohol fuels, this is one of the attractive as a fuel for automobile. In this alcohol, two types of alcohols which have the better qualities as far as the fuel is concerned, methanol and ethanol, these can be used. Particularly the methanol has an advantage. It is only the alcohol based motile fuel that can be transported readily by existing petroleum product. And ammonia can also be used as an alternative fuel for as a fuel to automotive industry. And hydrogen, even though presently the liquid hydrogen is used in air applications, but it is costly. But the advantage of hydrogen using as a fuel for automobile is the it is an emissionless fuel. The exhaust, it is it don't have any dangerous emittance from the exhaust from hydrogen as a fuel. But hydrogen as of now, it is very, very costly. And its application, liquid hydrogen I am talking, its application is restricted to the, what is this? Air applications. And still compressed air is also used as a fuel. And CNG, the artificial CNG can be used as a fuel. SCNG can be used as a fuel. Now we should see what are the types of combustion. There are, in if we look into the spark ignition engines or petrol engines, we have two types of combustion. One is normal combustion, another one is abnormal combustion. Normal combustion will not produce any untoward processes inside the engine. And as far as the normal combustion in spark ignition is concerned, it is a process where the fuel is burnt layer by layer, that is in a waveform. And this combustion will happen only with the help of spark. Okay. Under ideal conditions, the common internal combustion engine, that to spark ignition engine, burns the air fuel mixture in the cylinder in an orderly and controlled fashion. The combustion is started by the spark plug some 10 to 40 crankshaft degrees prior to the top dead center of the piston, depending on many factors, including engine speed and the load. This ignition advance allows, what is the advantage of having combustion before the piston reaches TDC? Oh, there are advantages by having this ignition advance, which allows time for combustion process to develop peak pressure at the ideal time for maximum recovery of work from expanding gases. Okay. And as far as, again, I will repeat, the normal combustion, it is the process where the fuel is burned with the help of only spark plug in a orderly fashion by layer. And this is how you can see how the normal combustion, it happens. Okay, left side BDC, right side BDC, at the center it is TDC. Okay, before the piston reaches TDC, you can see the one point it is shown here, this is where the ignition starts. Okay, and this kind of ignition will not produce any kind of shocks like detonation and all. So it is a, the curve, you can see it is a curve which don't have any zigzag lines in the curve. This is how the normal combustion, which is going, you see the figure, are you following? You see the figure, the movement of the flame front you can see, and the normal burning of the charge, that is mixture of air and petrol in the combustion chamber. Okay, the curve don't have any zigzag lines. That means it is an orderly combustion taking place. The combustion will take place layer by layer. Okay, it will not produce any untoward processes like detonation, or it will not produce any untoward processes like the shock waves which are going to expected due to sudden rise in pressure inside the combustion chamber. This is the figure as far as the normal combustion is concerned. Okay, just you go through this figure and you can have this. Okay, so you can see the flame front. Okay, you can see the flame front. Okay, it is moving. Once when the ignition starts, the spark which is produced, it starts igniting the mixture, and the spark keep on moving towards the flame front as far as the combustion chamber is concerned. And normal combustion, orderly fashion combustion, it is taking place, and the curve did not show any zigzag lines. That means it is an orderly combustion taking place, and which will not produce any kind. This is the normal combustion which we are going to now. As far as the abnormal combustion is concerned, as the name itself indicates, this combustion may not be normal. This combustion here, two types of the combustion will take place with the spark plug, as well as the combustion will take place without the formation of the spark plug. This is, and this abnormal combustion, we can define the abnormal combustion is the process where the fuel burns not only by spark, but also by self-ignition process, where a number of waves are waves of flames are produced from different parts of the cylinder. Abnormal combustion is the process where the fuel burns not only by spark but also by self-ignition process, where a number of waves of flames are produced from different parts of the cylinder. See here, you can see this is the abnormal combustion. Okay, so this is how you can find the zigzag lines. When unburned fuel air mixture behind the boundary of the flame front is subjected to a combination of heat and pressure for certain duration, the delay period of the fuel used, detonation may occur. Okay, detonation is characterized by an instantaneous explosive ignition of one or other part of the mixture outside the flame front. A local shock wave is created around each pocket and the cylinder pressure may rise sharply behind its design limits. Okay, now what are the effects of if the detonation is allowed to persist under extreme conditions or over many engine cycles? Engine parts can be damaged. And other adverse effects of detonation, this is the particle wear will take place and it will affect the lubrication qualities, lubricated oil qualities. Lubrication oil will lose its qualities, its lubricating qualities. Okay, this you can see the difference between the previous figure and this figure. See here, the portion you can find auto ignition. This you can see, this is auto ignition charge. Okay, here the knocking wave, the zigzag lines which shows the knocks, detonation or knock is produced. And this knock is a result of auto ignition without the support of the spark. Okay, this is how. Again, I'm going to describe once again what is this abnormal combustion. Abnormal combustion, this is the process where the fuel burns not only by spark but also by self-ignition process, where a number of waves of flames are produced from different parts of the cylinder. And you can see the previous figure, they don't have any, the normal combustion I'm talking, it was not having any kind of zigzag lines on the curve. Where you can find a zigzag lines in the curve, that zigzag lines will indicate the knocking wave detonation process or the pressure shocks indicate. And here you can see the auto ignition. This is auto ignition leads to knocking wave or shock wave or pressure wave, which leads to detonation process. And if the detonation may, if it continuously occurs over a longer duration of operation of the engine, this may damage to certain engine parts. Okay, and the particle wear may also take place. And okay, how the detonation can be prevented? How the detonation can be prevented? By using the fuel with high octane rating. High octane rating, in the sense, generally the fuel, the petrol, which is preferred for petrol engine, which will have an octane number rating from 80 to 90, which will have the better knocking resistant qualities. Okay, so how the detonation can be prevented? By using the fuel with high octane rating, high octane number, which increases the combustion temperature of the fuel and reduces the possibility to detonate, and reduces the possibility to detonate. And enriching the air fuel mixture, which alters the chemical reaction, during combustion, reduces the combustion temperature and increases the margin above detonation. Okay, it goes beyond the auto ignition temperature. By doing so, the detonation can be minimized or prevented. Okay, detonation can also be prevented by reducing peak cylinder pressure. Detonation can also be prevented by producing peak cylinder pressure. That means the compression, at the end of the compression, more and more pressure can be achieved. How it is possible to achieve? Already we have seen, by supercharging, we can to some extent reduce the distance. And decreasing the manifold pressure by reducing the throttle opening, boost pressure, or reducing the load on the engine. These are the four different methods whereby the detonation can be prevented. Whereby the detonation can be prevented or minimized. Okay. Now we should see the rating of petrol fuel and diesel fuel. C10 and octane number. Generally, C10 it is referred to diesel, and octane it is referred to petrol. And as far as the C10 numbers are concerned, generally the diesel which is preferred for diesel engine, which will have a C10 number of 40 to 60. Then what is this C10 number? In diesel engines, the C10 number is a measure of ignition lag. Okay, ignition lag, this is the main parameter through which the C10 number is allocated. And C10, what is this C10? We should know what is the C10. C10 is a straight chain paraffin assigned with a rating of 100 C10 number, and it has good ignition quality. It has very good ignition quality. And this straight chain paraffin, it is, once when it is mixed with hexamethyl naphthalene, a hydrocarbon with poor ignition quality, and that is with zero C10 number. Okay. See, the hexamethyl naphthalene hydrocarbon, this is having very poor ignition quality. So it is rated as zero. Okay. So how the C10 numbers are allocated? C10 numbers are allocated with a CFR organ. What is the CFR organization? Corporation Fuel Research, which is existing in United States of America. And this CFR, Corporation Fuel Research, will have a testing engine, and in that engine, the air fuel mixture is tested, and thereby the C10 numbers are allocated. Again, I'm telling, C10, it is a mixture of good ignition quality, that is the straight chain paraffin, and poor ignition quality, that is hexamethyl naphthalene. Okay. For diesel engine, C10 rating is a measure of its quality to auto-ignite readily when it is ignited into the engine cylinder at the end of the compression chamber. So the diesel should be ignited as soon as it is injected into the engine cylinder at the end of the compression. Okay, that C10 rating, it is recommended for diesel engine. The ignition delay, what do you mean by ignition delay? It is the time of the injection of the diesel and the time of the combustion commencement. This is called ignition delay. Ignition delay is influenced by several engine design parameters such as compression ratio, injection rate, injection time, inlet air temperature, etc. Okay, I was telling, diesel engine operate well with a C10 number from 40 to 60. The fuels with lower C10 number have longer ignition delay. Okay, the ignition delay, whatever the diesel we are going to prefer as a fuel for diesel engine, it should have minimum ignition delay quality. Okay, that is possible with the diesel with a C10 number which is having between C10 number between 40 and 60. Okay. Okay, the higher speed diesel engines operate more effectively with higher C10 numbers. What is the higher C10 number? 60. Beyond 60 also, if we use, it is meaningless. It will not produce any good effectiveness as far as the ignition delay parameters are concerned. Generally, the preferred C10 number for diesel as a fuel for diesel engine is the CTN number in the range of 40 to 60. Now we should see what is octane number. Okay, as far as this octane number is concerned, it is referred to petrol engine, and this octane numbers are allocated based on the detonation characteristics. Whereas in CTN numbers in case of diesel engine, the CTN number is allocated based on the quality of ignition delay. Okay, the composition of fuel affects mainly detonation. In spark ignition engines for a particular fuel, the rating is done by comparing its performance with that of a standard reference fuel. Okay, the rating of any petrol, it is and its performance, and it is compared with a standard reference fuel, which is a combination of iso-octane and n-heptane. Iso-octane offers great resistance to detonation, and it is assigned a rating of 100 octane number. On the other hand, n-heptane is a straight chain paraffin and is giving a very poor resistance to the detonation, and the rating of 0 octane number is allocated for this. The percentage of iso-octane by volume in a mixture of iso-octane and naphthalene, which exactly matches the knocking intensity of a given fuel in a standard engine prescribed by operating conditions, are termed as octane number. And here this octane number is also tested in CFR. What is the CFR? Corporation of Fuel Research, and they have one standard engine. There they are going to test the fuel, and the fuel is tested until knocking is attained. Once when knocking is attained, then we can find trace out behind this. It is recommended for a fuel as far as the fuel is concerned to this petrol engine. And the preferred octane number should be in the range of 80 to 90. Okay, what do you mean by 80? If, for example, if the fuel number is 80, okay, that means this 80 octane number by volume, it consists of 80% of iso-octane and 20% of n-heptane. The preferred octane number for petrol engine, it should be in the range of 80 to 90. Okay, now we should discuss about the mixture requirement for spark ignition engine or petrol. See, so the engine is going to operate at different operating conditions based on the load on the engine, the speed on the engine, and other conditions like starting the engine, a cold starting engine, and acceleration condition. For all these different operating conditions, the engine requires different air fuel mixture. For example, once when the engine is running on a flat road in the straight ahead position, then it requires the stoichiometrically chemical correctly air fuel. What is the stoichiometric air fuel mixture? Stoichiometric correct air fuel mixture is 15 to 1. 15 is the percentage of air, 1 is the percentage of fuel. Okay, this is the standard reference point. This is based on this, we are going to consider, we are going to describe lean mixture, rich mixture. And we should see, for starting a warm condition of the engine, what kind of fuel is required? For starting the engine, rich mixture is required. Okay, once when the automobile is running on the road, due to some conditions, the vehicle should be accelerated. During this acceleration of vehicle, the engine needs rich air fuel mixture. Okay, rich, how do you reach? By you rich, how you are going to make the fuel rich? By decreasing the percentage of air. How we are going to make the lean mixture? By increasing the air, but percentage of fuel. So now, in steady state operation of the engine, at normal speed of the engine requires the normal air fuel mixture, that is chemically stoichiometric correct air fuel mixture. And for idling of the engine, What kind of air fuel mixture is required for idling of the engine? Rich air fuel mixture is required. Rich air fuel. For cruising the engine, mixture must be lean. Cruising in the sense, whenever the vehicle is rolling on downside and high power, once whenever the vehicle is moving upward of a hill like, there which kind of air fuel mixture is needed? There the enriched air fuel mixture is needed. The, for different operating conditions of the engine, it whether it may be cold starting, whether it may be starting, whether it may be accelerating, whether it may be idling, whether it may be cruising, or whether it may be climbing the hill, different air fuel mixtures are required by the engine. Now we should see carburetor. What is this carburetor? Already we were discussing about carburetor. This carburetor is a device which produces a proportionate air fuel mixture which is required by spark ignition engine. And remember, this carburetor is present in case of petrol engine. This carburetor is not present in case of diesel engines. Okay. How this carburetor works? This carburetor works. How the carburetor works, on what principle the carburetor works? The carburetor works on Bernoulli's theorem. Bernoulli's theorem. Okay. So, what is the main function? The main function of carburetor is it mixes the liquid petrol and air inside the carburetor, and the same thing it is supplied to the engine cylinder. Okay. So, this is how the carburetor. And what are the main objectives of carburetor? What carburetor must do? Carburetor must do, the main objective of carburetor is it measures the airflow of the engine. How much amount of air is required by the engine? And it also should see that it should deliver the correct amount of fuel to keep the fuel air mixture in the proper range, adjusting the factors such as temperature. Mix the two finely and evenly. What are the mix? The air and petrol should be mixed finely and evenly according to the requirement of engine. These are the three important objective. What are the important objective of carburetor? Carburetor must measure the airflow of the engine. It should deliver the correct amount of fuel to keep the fuel air fuel mixture in proper range according to the requirement of the engine. And the carburetor must mix, the carburetor must mix the proportionate and fine mixing of air and petrol, and evenly mixing of air petrol should happen in the carburetor. These are the three important. And before we see different carburetors, we should see the functioning of simple carburetor. What is this simple carburetor? Generally, the carburetor, it consists of, I'll show the figure, then I will explain and we'll understand. See, you will have a venturi. At the top, choke is there. You can see the figure. And the fuel, the here float chamber is there. From this float chamber, the fuel is supplied to the what is this? The nozzle area, the venturi, primary venturi and secondary venturi are there. You can see here. Okay. And it consists of, at the bottom, it is having a valve. This is called throttle valve. And from here, it goes to the engine cylinder. This is how. Okay. This is the simple figure of a simple carburetor. Okay. This simple carburetor basically consists of an, see, you can see the figure. It basically consists of an open pipe through which the air passes into the inlet manifold of the engine. The pipe is in the form of, is at the center you can see. The pipe is in the form of a venturi. It narrows in section and then widens again, causing airflow to increase in velocity in the narrowest part. Below the venturi, you can see a butterfly valve that is called the throttle valve. Okay, with this throttle valve, this is the main valve which controls the amount of air fuel mixture to the engine according to the engine requirement. Okay, and then the throttle is connected at the bottom. Usually it is at the bottom of this thing, and this throttle is connected to the accelerator pad. It is connected to the accelerator. Fuel is inducted into the fuel from the, you see the float you are looking at. Are you seeing the float? The float and the needle valve is there. The fuel is introduced into the stream through the small holes at the narrowest part of the venturi, at the narrowest part of the venturi and other places according to the requirement, and fuel flow to the narrowest part of the venturi. It is adjusted with the help of, are you seeing the needle valve? With the help of needle valve. This is how the mixing of air and petrol will take place in the narrowest position of the carburetor, that is nozzle, whereby we will have two kinds of venturi. One is secondary venturi, bottom, it is called the primary venturi. Once when the air is made to pass through this narrow region, its velocity increases, its pressure decreases, and this narrow region only, the petrol is introduced into this region where air and fuel is mixed and it is applied to the engine cylinder. Okay, now what are the different types of carburetors? Can be classified as updraft carburetors, down draft carburetors, horizontal draft carburetors. According to the direction in which air and fuel mixture is supplied, these carburetors are classified. And another broader way of classification of carburetors are concerned, the choke carburetor and the vacuum carburetor. Carburetors can also be classified as the choke carburetor and constant draft carburetor. Okay, the examples of choked carburetor, simple carburetor, which we have seen, Solex carburetor, Zenith carburetor, and Carter carburetors. These are the example of choke carburetor. And the example of vacuum carburetor or constant draft carburetor, this is SU type of carburetor. SU type of carburetor. Now we should see what is Solex carburetor. Okay, we should see the Solex carburetor. Okay, the Solex carburetor, it is a downdraft type and a choke type of carburetor, and it is manufactured in India by Carburetor Limited Private Limited, Madras. It is famous for ease of starting, good performance and reliability. It is available in various models and used in Fiat and standard cars and Willys Jeeps. The unique feature of this carburetor is the bi-starter or cold starting. I will explain how this carburetor works with figure. You can see this is the figure. Okay, so there are different circuits you can find here. Just you go through the figure which I am going to discuss. Okay, so normal running, one circuit will be there. Okay, during this normal running, four different circuits are there. Normal running circuit you can find, cold starting and warming of the engine you can find another circuit, idling or slow speed operation, this is another circuit, and acceleration, this is another circuit. These circuits are based on according to the air fuel requirements to the engine, the different circuits. And as for the normal running, you can see the figure. You look into the figure. Already I have circulated this complete text of this. Okay, as far as the normal running is concerned, the carburetor has a conventional float in the float chamber. You can see the float. This is the float chamber. This is the float chamber. Okay, the carburetor has a conventional float in the float chamber. For normal running, the throttle is held partly. Throttle, you can see at the bottom, this is 12.12. The throttle is held partly open, and fuel is supplied by the main jet and air by the choke tube. Or when choke at the top, you can see the choke, you can find air, the direction downward you are seeing. Okay, Here choke will be there. Okay. And as far as the supply of fuel to the narrowest section is concerned, for this normal running is the main jet will supply the petrol from the float chamber to the narrowest region. And as far as the cold starting and warming is concerned, this carburetor has provision of bi-starter. As I was telling, this is the advantageous feature of this Solex carburetor. The starter valve is a flat disc having holes of different sizes. This cold starter, it is having different sizes of holes, and these holes connect starter petrol jet. And you can see the starter 12, 13, 14. Okay, you can see there. You can the holes connect the starter petrol jet and starter air jet to the passage which opens just below the throttle valve, just below the throttle valve. Okay, this you can find. Okay, this starter lever is to be brought to the intermediate. Once when the during cold starting more fuel is supplied to the narrowest region, then the starter lever is brought into the intermediate. This starter lever should be brought into the intermediate. I should bring here. This starter lever should be brought into the intermediate position after starting the engine. This connects the smaller holes into circuit, and this reduces the amount of petrol once when the engine has started from the cold starting. So during starting, more fuel is required, and the larger holes are provided to the larger holes. Fuel is introduced into the once when the engine has started, the lever is brought to the middle position, whereby it connects the smaller holes, whereby the small amount of petrol is sufficient for running condition. And another very important circuit you can see here, this is the idling or slow speed operation. An idle port is provided, an idle port is provided, 14. You can see this is, I will bring here. This is idle port, okay? An idle port is controlled by idle adjusting screw is provided in the engine side or throttle valve. The emulsion system is well connected to the pilot jet through a hole. Okay. And at idling, the throttle is almost closed. What do you mean? Once when the throttle is almost closed, that means what happens? The airflow is restricted. Airflow is restricted. Okay. The petrol and air mix in the idle passage, and mixture comes out of the idle port. Okay. And another very important thing is, you can see the acceleration circuit. This is very, very important. Okay. During acceleration also, the engine requires rich mixture. During acceleration also, all you concentrate on figure itself. I am telling which point, which number here it is shown. Okay. This consists of a diaphragm type. It consists of a diaphragm type. It consists of a diaphragm type where you can see it consists of a diaphragm type accelerating pump. Okay, you can see the figure, the portion 8, you can see. 8, you can see. Okay. It delivers spurt of extra fuel needed for acceleration through the pump injector. Okay. Pump lever is connected to the accelerator pedal. The pump lever, it is directly connected to the accelerator pedal. Once when the accelerator pedal is pressed, lever moves towards left, thus pressing the membrane to the left. This forces petrol into the main jet circuit through pump jet and injector. When the petrol is left free, the lever moves diaphragm back to its original position, and thereby again, the required amount will be only once when the accelerator pedal is pressed. During that duration, this pump injector will provide more petrol to the main jet. That means during this once when the accelerator pedal is pressed, that means the engine has to be accelerated. During that situation, more fuel has to be supplied to the this Venturi region, okay, and thereby a rich mixture is produced and it is supplied. Okay, this is how the Solex carbohydrate works, and this is manufactured in India, Madras, and it is used in many vehicles and jeeps also. And Zenith carbohydrate, this is most commonly used in all the maximum petrol engines. Okay, so this consists of a float control, starting jet, compensating jet, acceleration, and choking. And here we don't have any additional bi-starter as was noticed in Solex carburetor. I will bring the figure so that I can explain here. You can see here, okay? You can see main jet, you can see cab jet, you can see idling jet, you can see, and this is the Venturi, you can see. I will show. This is the Venturi, you can see, and this is the float chamber, you can see. Okay, this is the float, this thing, these are the float balls, and the this is the fuel tank. Okay, this you can see, and I will explain one by one. I will keep on putting the cursor how this Zenith carburetor works. Okay, it is having a float control. That is float control, it has having a float chamber. You can see the figure. Here the balls, okay, 3-4 balls are having. Here only one ball is shown, like this 2-3 balls will be there, okay. The balls are resting on the conventional float. The, as the engine speed increases, the fuel consumption will be more and fuel level in the float chamber decreases. Okay, as a result, the float balls, it comes down, and the needle wall, the here you can find, this is the needle wall, it goes up, and through this opened wall the fuel is supplied to the float chamber, whereby once when the level of this float chamber come to the predetermined level, again the balls will move up and the additional fuel which is entering into the float chamber, it is stopped. And starting jet, you can see a starting jet, you can see here main 3 jets are there. Okay, so a starting jet, during starting the compensatory well is completely filled with fuel. The throttle valve is slightly open, and whole engine suction near the throttle valve point. Where is the throttle valve point? So this you can see, this is the throttle valve. Okay, and compensating jet. Okay, so this compensating jet, this is I'll bring the cab, this is cab jet, this is the compensating jet. Okay, this supplies the additional fuel required during accelerating or during starting of the this thing to the narrowest region of the engine. What is this compensating jet circuit? Okay, the compensating jet is a double jet deliver, and it delivers lean mixture to the, to make the mixture to be rich, supplied by the main jet under increased speed condition of the engine. Under increased fuel condition, the area of main jet and the compensating jet is equivalent to single main jet, which is used in simple carburetor. So the whatever the this area and this area clubbed together in simple carburetor, the same area will be formed. Okay, and during acceleration, as far as the acceleration is concerned, in Zenith carburetor, no separate device, as I was quoting, the a separate device was there in the previous case. What is this in Solex carburetor? That is bi starter, which is not available in this Zenith carburetor. Okay, then how this additional fuel is supplied to the engine for increased speed of the engine. Okay, in Zenith carburetor, no separate device is used for acceleration. Sudden acceleration of the engine is not possible when throttle is fully open. When the throttle is fully open. Okay, so what is going to happen? It is full of fuel only. The main jet or the compressor jet, it is filled only during starting, okay, and after starting it is empty and it has to be refilled and supply the fuel during sudden acceleration. This is how here also the compensating jet will support additional fuel along with the main jet whenever the engine speed is increased. But here we don't have any separate arrangement as was noticed in case of Solex carburetor. In Solex carburetor, we had by starter. Here we don't have. Okay, that is met in the system with the compensatory jet only. And this is how you can see, once again you can see the figure. This is the compression chamber, this is the float, and here two to three balls will be there. This is the fuel pump, and you can find here, okay, different jets you can find, and this is compensatory jet, and this is main jet, okay, and this is the venturi, and this is the throttle, okay. This is how the venturi it works, okay. Almost the working is similar to Solex, but except here we don't have the bi starter system. And SU carburetor, this SU carburetor, it is a type of a vacuum type of carburetors. This SU carburetor, okay, it is a vacuum type of carburetor, and the mixture compensation is achieved by maintaining a constant vacuum over the jet and varying effective size of jet, as the name itself indicates. Here, by creating the vacuum inside the carburetor, the required air fuel mixture is prepared in the carburetor according to the requirement of the engine, according to the requirement. Okay, here a spring loaded piston controls the air passage, which is in the form of rectangular opening or constant width with adjustable height. Okay, and damper plunger piston will be there. I will explain better with the figure. You can see this is the SU carburetor. Here you can see the float, or you just concentrate on this figure. Okay, this is very, very important carburetor. This is a vacuum type of carburetor. You can find float chamber, jet, and you can find the throttle valve, and you can see the suction air entrance, suction disc, suction chamber, piston rod guide, piston rod, and different components you can see. Okay, and how this works, I will tell you. The jet adjusting, okay, the jet adjusting, this is the jet, okay. I will explain how this completely works. Jet adjusting nut is used to adjust mixture strength, air fuel mixture strength, okay. Tightening the nut will raise the jet and reduces the annular area for fuel flow. Similarly, loosening the nut lowers the net. If the nuts are lowered, okay, it lowers the jet, thus increases the fuel supply to the narrowest region. The unique feature of this SU carburetor, vacuum type of carburetor, is that it has only one jet. Okay, in previous cases we have, in Solex carburetor you look into Zenit carburetor, we have main jet, we have compensating jet, we have accelerating jet, different kind of jet. Here only one jet is there. Okay, it works with the only one jet. By doing so, the cost is also decreases. Okay, this is the unique feature. The unique feature of this carburetor is that it has only one jet. A constant high velocity across the jet is maintained even under idling conditions, and the necessity for separate idling jet is eliminated in this thing. Okay, for cold starting, a rich mixture is required, and this is done by lowering the jet. Once when the jet is lowered, at what condition jet is lowered? Once when the nut is loosened, Once when the nut is loosened, the jet lowers, it supplies rich mixture. Okay. For cold starting, again, you just see the figure. For cold starting, a rich mixture is required. This is done by lowering the jet tube. This is done by lowering the jet tube away from the needle by means of the jet lever. How jet lever? If the nuts are loosened, the jet level comes down. Thereby, it supplies more fuel so that rich mixture is prepared and rich mixture is supplied to the engine cylinder. Okay, and another important type of carburetor, which we can see this carburetor is Carter carburetor. And as far as the Carter carburetor is concerned, this carburetor is an American make. It is manufactured in America. And it is used in Jeep and other automobiles. Okay, it is a downdraft type and choke type of carburetor. The venturi is kept, the small venturi is kept above the throat chamber. I will show the figure, then you will understand. Okay, it will have, this carburetor consists of different circuits. Float chamber circuit, we are having. Starting circuit we have, idle and low speed circuit we have, part and full throttle circuit we have, acceleration circuit we have. Okay, I will show with figure one by one circuit I will explain. This is the figure. Okay, I think you have to enlarge it and you can see, and different parts are mentioned. I will explain one by one. Float chamber, it consists of a float chamber. So where I will bring the cursor here. This is the float chamber. Okay, it consists of a conventional float and a float chamber. Fuel enters the float chamber from the main supply. What is the main supply? From the fuel tank. A needle valve maintains the fuel level in the float chamber. When the fuel level falls, the needle valve opens and the inlet to admit more fuel. Okay, starting circuit. Okay, I will explain the starting circuit. Here you can find 15. For starting, a choke valve is provided in the air. See, from here, air enters. This is the choke valve. For starting, choke valve is provided for the air circuit. It is mounted eccentrically. When the engine is fully choked, that is fully closed, whole of the engine suction is applied to the main nozzle, which then delivers the fuel. And idle and low speed circuit, for idling condition and this reduction of the speed. In this carburetor, separate idling passage is provided with low speed port. Okay, so here you can, I will bring the this thing. This is, okay. In this carburetor, separate idling passage is provided with low speed port. I am putting the cursor same. You see the figure where the cursor is moving. Okay, this is okay. For in this carburetor, separate idling passage is provided with low speed port and idle port. For idling, rich mixture is required in small quantity and throttle idling rich mixture is prepared. Okay, for idling. Rich mixture is required, but a small quantity of rich mixture is required. Whereas for accelerating the engine, rich mixture is required there also, but more quantity and continuous quantity of rich mixture is required. Whereas in case of idling, rich mixture is required, small quantity of rich mixture is required. Okay, and another one is part and full throttle circuit. Okay. This is very, very important. And this is found only in type of, in this type of carburetor. Other types of carburetor also, a full throttle, everything is being made. But in those, we don't have any separate provision in previous carburetors. But in this Carter carburetor, we have a separate provision for part and full throttle circuit. For this thing, okay. See here. This you can see the cursor I am. This is the provision. In pot throttling, fuel is delivered by the main nozzle only. During full throttling, maximum air is passing through the venturi. And to compensate this higher rate of fuel flow is designed. This is obtained by mechanical meter. I am keeping this. This is obtained by mechanical metering method, which uses a metering rod having a number of steps of diameter sizes at the bottom. Okay. Here, what is going to happen is when the accelerator pedal is pressed, the throttle is held wide open, and simultaneously the meter rod is lifted up. In this condition, the smallest diameter of the rod is inside the fuel hole. It provides the larger flow area for more fuel to be introduced into the venturi area. And accelerating circuit we have, and the similar circuit we have, as we have seen in case of this thing. In the previous case. And here we'll stop.